Why do vitamin E requirements stay elevated for 4 years when we stop eating PUFA?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Hi, Chris. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. How are you today?
Good, thanks. Thanks for all your generous information. You're really helpful. Looking forward to your book, and I have been reading through, I guess, some of that pre stuff, but it's not referenced. So sometimes I don't know where to go look to find out more about something.
Sure.
And one of those questions was about PUFAs and vitamin E. I posted it. So you said that your vitamin E requirements stay elevated for 4 years after you stop consuming PUFAs. So I was just interested in that one because I assume there wasn't an experiment where people couldn't consume PUFAs for 4 years because, you know, it's kind of hard to avoid them in the diet. So I'm wondering if you can just elaborate on that and make that reference available, or maybe it will be available in your book, just so I can look that up in some more detail.
Yeah. Okay, great. So first of all, everything will be fully referenced in the book, which, as you can imagine, when I was throwing these together as fast as I could, going back and referencing everything is an extremely difficult, time-consuming process. And it seems like it'll be quick because I'm like, oh, I know where that comes from. But then it like take hours to get through a couple paragraphs. And so that's... again, there's nothing I can do about it. I did it that way.
I've written books. I understand.
Yeah. Okay. So the best way to get these references, because that particular topic I have written about in an area in an article where it is referenced. I'm gonna share my screen. Hopefully not doxing myself in any way that I can tell. All right. So. All right. So the best way to get this is to Google AJCN Old Days Masterjohn, and the top result will be AJCN publishes a new PUFA study that should make us ... And this was written years ago, in 2012, in fact, so 9 years ago. And this is a blog about a particular study that came out it was like a 2-week study on fatty liver, on saturated fat versus polyunsaturated fat. And, but I happened to make this article really long and have sections that give a lot of context. And I happened to discuss the exact papers you're talking about. So if you scroll down, way past most of this stuff, and then, I'm screen sharing and a lot going on there. All right. So if you scroll down to where it says a more nuanced version, then you will get a discussion of exactly those things. So what I'm showing you here, and these references are linked in the article. The main two references are the main publication of the LA Veterans Administration Hospital study, where they actually had an 8.5-year study where they had inpatients in a mental hospital, and there were two dining halls, and they randomized people with color-coded tickets to go to one dining hall or the other. And for 8.5 years, they fed the exact same meal in each dining hall, except one dining hall took out the saturated fats and put in polyunsaturated fats. And so the main thing they were trying to look at was cardiovascular disease, but they also happened to take adipose biopsies over the whole course of this. And so that's one thing.
Okay. And, controversial study, yes.
Yeah. So, well, I mean, it's controversial because of the interpretation of the clinical effects. But it's not controversial that they substituted saturated fat for polyunsaturated fat in a highly controlled manner And I don't see any reason why the adipose biopsies of linoleic acid in the adipose tissue should be controversial. So I think that aspect of it, I think, is very straightforward. And so I believe these are like scanned from paper, but this is linoleic acid as a percent of adipose tissue fatty acids. And so you can see over 0 to 3,000 days on the experimental diet, you can see it's plateauing around, it doesn't increase much here. So the big increase is in the first few years, and then it kind of plateaus here. I mean, it's hard to know if it truly plateaued. Like maybe it goes up tiny, tiny, tiny percentage. But the bulk of this, sorry, every time I put my cursor over it, it shows this sharing sign. But so the bulk of the increase is taking place over the first 1,000 days, which is, you know, approximately 3 years. And then it's continuing to increase at least over 2,000 days before it plateaus. And the increase over time is pretty small after that. So you can see it's taking 4, 5, 6 years to fully saturate adipose tissue. That's one part of it. And then this other paper is from... this is from another study where this must... I believe this is a review by Horwitz. Yeah, okay. This guy Horwitz did a lot of study, stuff on how the PUFAs require the PUFAs affect the vitamin E requirement, and what did this open in a new tab? Hold on. All right. So unfortunately, in that paper, they described the results and they didn't provide graphs of everyone's data, which we would kind of expect now, but they showed some representative graphs. And so this is showing if you switch someone back onto a diet that is low in PUFA, how long does it take to run out? Let's see, linoleic acid and tocopherols. So actually, this looks like it's running out in more like a year. But I haven't reviewed this data in years. So I'm not sure. I believe they found in there that it could take up to 4 years, but at first glance, that data seems to suggest a year. I'd have to go back and look at it. So, and then here, this is from the LA Veterans Administration Hospital study. This is a, not from the main practical book that they wrote. That was like 100 pages, but this is from one of the follow-up papers that was more like a normal paper size. And this was looking at plasma vitamin E and months of safflower, adipose linoleate percentage over here. And so let's see, these units on the bottom are months of safflower oil feeding. And what you can see is that the adipose linoleate is going up basically linearly over the first 30 months, so close to 3 years, and then it's basically plateauing here. And what you see over here is that you would think with more safflower oil, because safflower oil is so high in vitamin E, that the plasma tocopherol would basically just keep going up until it reaches a plateau point. But what it actually does is it goes up linearly up through the first like 15 months. And then it starts to taper off, and then it goes down and basically levels off at this point that's like about half the increase. And so what that's showing is that now there's bound to be some controversy over here, because you say, like, at what point is vitamin E status high enough to protect you from the safflower oil? Well, you know, one way to look at it is at the end, plasma tocopherol is still higher than it was at the beginning. And that's kind of what their interpretation was. Their interpretation was basically like, there's a concern that you could deplete the vitamin E pool with the PUFAs, but actually it winds up, you know, being normal at the end. And in fact, the status is slightly better than it was at the beginning. But another way to look at it is the relationship fundamentally changes after about 15 months, where the vitamin E is increasing as a result of continually eating more vitamin E in the safflower oil. But then the trend changes and it goes down, and that's reflecting that adipose tissue is enriching in linoleate, which is sucking the vitamin E into the adipose tissue to protect it there. And the vitamin E turnover in the adipose tissue is faster than the linoleate turnover. And you would expect that because vitamin E is, its purpose is to sacrifice itself to protect the PUFA. And the purpose of PUFA in adipose tissue is to stay there. Right. You store fat in adipose tissue just to store it, right? And so you would expect the vitamin E turnover to be a lot faster than the linoleate turnover. It is, and it takes years to play out. So none of this really proves that, you know, long-term long-term vitamin E status is compromised, and that will make the clinical effect of PUFA be net negative after 4 or 5 years. But it does show you that the general relationship between the fact that you get more vitamin E when you eat PUFA oils, right? Because in the plant doesn't have this turnover problem. Plant makes vitamin E whenever it wants, and it has a certain amount of PUFA for some purpose, and it loads it up. And so the plant has the amount of vitamin E that is needed to protect those PUFA under those conditions. So the question is, does a person, human being eating that oil also benefit from that relationship between vitamin E and PUFA that the safflower plant made? But the answer to that, I mean, the answer to that is controversial, right? But the key part of that question is that the safflower oil doesn't care about you. The safflower oil plant made that relationship for itself under the conditions that the PUFA need to be protected in that seed. Period, end of story. Doesn't give a damn about human beings. So what this is showing you is, you know, over the course of many years, it looks really great for the human benefiting from that safflower plant's wisdom at 15 months out. But it looks a lot less great at 30 months out. And at 60 months out, it looks basically kind of blah as it did at 30 months out. And so what does that mean for a clinical effect is controversial. But part of the reason that the LA Veterans Administration Hospital study is so interesting, apart from the fact that they are the only study to have ever been able to provide long-term data with a large sample of people on this, is that, and I think these, I'm pretty sure I had these graphs earlier in the article. So if you look at, let's kind of get to the point here. If you look at, first of all, cancer. So the first 2 years of the study, there's no difference in cancer between the two groups. Experimental group is the PUFA group. Control group is the, right, you know, the old fats, traditional fats group. And you see that the cancer incidence starts diverging around 2 years. And it really starts diverging around year five. And so at a, you know, at a minimum, this is suggestive that whatever the study told you at 0.2 years was worthless knowledge, because, you know, if you're making a public health recommendation to apply to the whole population for a lifetime, whatever happens at 5, 6, 7 years is far more relevant than whatever happened at 2 years. And so this basically just says, like, well, a 2-year study is a liar. Because if this study had stopped at 2 years, it would have told you the totally wrong thing. Mm-hmm. And then from the perspective of total mortality, you really can't read anything into this. It basically looks the same the whole time. But you have to wonder at the end, like, it does look at, like, it starts diverging, where the percentage surviving is higher in the control group than in the experimental group. But it's like, you know, is that noise that would have regressed to the mean at year 9? I don't know. But, you know, when you look at the cancer, when you zoom in on the cancer, you have to wonder, right? Because in the earlier part of the study, mortality is dominated by heart disease. In the latter part of the study, mortality is dominated by cancer, which is just reflective of the fact that people net get cancer later than they get heart disease. right? And so, you know, over the past century, people stopped dying of infectious diseases early in their life, and they got old enough to get heart disease. Then people started surviving heart disease mainly because you could argue about it, probably not because of PUFAs, probably because of hospital treatment. And, you know, when people started surviving heart attacks, they started getting old enough to get cancer. And so cancer incidence goes up. And I'm not saying nothing else matters, but, you know, that general trend is going to be true with people who started at any certain given age. That's the other thing that's interesting about the LA Veterans Administration Hospital study is that the people were older in that study than they were in most of the other studies. So they're actually old enough to get cancer. And so, you know, you can't read anything into this with any kind of certainty or, you know, even confidence. But it does make you wonder, and it doesn't make you wonder in a direction that looks positive for PUFAs. And, you know, to me, it's like my suspicion is if this went out to 10 years, then the PUFA group would have had higher total mortality driven by the higher cancer mortality. And the CVD benefit, if that's real, would have worn off. And so I'm going to stop sharing my screen now. You know, so that's the gist of it. Do you want to follow up on that?
Well, just a quick clarification. Firstly, when I said controversial, it's more to do with regarding cholesterol around that study, not PUFAs. I was just surprised. My impression that with those highly processed oils like safflower, sunflower, that the vitamin E would be negligible because of the processing. So Just wondered about.
That's not true. And they measure the vitamin E in the oils, and the vitamin E certainly survives. I mean, I'm not sure how bad they were processed, but generally most commercial oils are not processed enough to get rid of the vitamin E.
Okay.
In fact, the vitamin E DRI, the RDA for vitamin E, is set based on a study that I believe was done in prisoners, where they were trying to see what amount of vitamin E depletion will cause in vitro red blood cell hemolysis. And they tried feeding oils that had like no vitamin E. They tried feeding real low vitamin E natural diets, and they couldn't find a vitamin E intake low enough to cause red blood cell hemolysis. By hemolysis, I'm talking about they remove the red blood cells and then they dump hydrogen peroxide on them, right? So it should be easy. And so what they had to do was they had to feed them tocopherol stripped corn oil. And to strip corn oil of tocopherol, you have to heat it over and over and over again to the point where it's like totally rancid. And so I don't know what that tastes like, but I don't think they would be able to sell oil in the market to people who use it and then would buy it again without complaining about it if it was actually depleted of its vitamin E, because I think it would be too rancid.
Okay. Thanks, Chris. And that was a very comprehensive answer. Can't complain. Thank you.
You're welcome. Take care. Thalia.
Thanks.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ Masterpass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the Masterpass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. From now through February or March, whatever it takes to get it done, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for my consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.